guys. Welcome to tonight's show.
I'm Wendy.
I'm Zeleny, and welcome to Friday Night Fight. We'll start off by saying tonight's show is not intended for children due to language, alcohol, topics that we discuss.
And no way are we affiliated or sponsored by any brands
whatsoever, and we're not paid to do this at all. Everything that we say is purely our opinion. And we'll start today's show with what we normally do, our shots. We're taking New Amsterdam watermelon. We hope you have your shots ready. Cheers. Our mixologist is gonna mix her mixed drink today, and she'll tell you what it is.
We didn't name it because we just DS'd it, so I can't. Y'all can name it. I don't even know. So we're gonna add some sparkling ice, orange passion fruit. We're gonna add some mucho mango Arizona. Now the fun part, we're gonna add some Crown Royale honey. And as you see, nothing's measured. We just eyeball it, so I guess when you make it, you can make it to your own taste. And some pineapple parfait. Oh, let's push that off. There's no point in keeping a little bit of mouth in a bottle. Might as well finish it.
Just pour the whole bottle in, who cares?
Like, I just don't like keeping small amounts of bottles. I'm like, that's a bunch of space for no reason. And, moment of truth. I'm just doing it off screen so I don't make a mess. Here's yours.
Let's try this.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. For BSing it, it's really good, actually. Let us know what you're drinking tonight.
This is like a nice summer drink.
It is. It's nice, refreshing, sweet.
It is.
I mean, if you like sweet, I like sweet.
I like sweet.
So we have three topics that we're gonna discuss today. It's transgender in sports.
Toxic traits
and education. So with education, we have charter schools, public schools,
fundings, school to jail pipeline, a whole bunch of topics goes under education.
Cheers. So first we'll start with transgenders in sports. It's a big one. It's one that a lot of people have opinions on. I have my own opinion. You have your own opinion. We'd like to hear what they are. Wendy has her opinion on it. And we have a lot of facts that go with it. And even if there's facts, you may not agree with it. I know I don't.
It's a very new subject because now that we're becoming more accepting, it's like, so how do we open up so that it's equal to everyone? And I personally believe, unfortunately, you can't make everything equal for everyone. But in trying to do so, there's always going to be someone that's going to feel some type of way. That's what it comes down to.
I mean, don't get me wrong. I am purely open to however you want to feel and whatever you resonate with. But as far as it being with a sport and competing with the opposite sex, even though you resonate with that sex, I am personally not open with it, especially having a child in a sport when it comes to that.
I agree with you to a certain extent. Like, maybe if they had, I don't want to be like a transgender team, but like, I almost kind of feel like it needs to be like a special part of the team because it's not really fair for them to compete with everyone else. Because like, from a man going to a woman competing against other women, you have some physical advantages over us. Just because you changed sex, those advantages didn't go away.
Right. I know biologically, if you're a man, let's just say when you're running, I don't know, or sprinting, I don't know the term for it, but if you're sprinting and you're going against me, I can't, well, let's just say I can't run to save my life. You won't ever catch me running, even if there's a dog behind me. I can't run, but if you put a guy next to me and, okay, yes, he has or she has had certain surgeries to be a woman, she is still brolic on the inside and she still has stamina as a male.
I mean, just because you change certain aspects to be a female, your strides are still going to be different from mine, because naturally I was born with a stride, you were born with a male stride,
right?
Like, because, you know, our hips are, we're different. Like, our women's hips are made for bearing children. Like, we men's aren't made for all that. They don't have to worry about
no,
to have
and,
a baby,
and their legs are generally wider, or if they're not wider and they're more smaller, they have a faster physique. I'm sorry to say it.
Yeah.
Or let's just say, what is that fast swimmer? The guy that's a
Michael Phelps?
Yes. He has his wingspan. I was reading this and I did look up information. His wingspan is different. So when he's stroking, I'm sorry. So when he's stroking, he's pulling in a whole bunch more than a woman. So let's just say he decided to, change sex and now wants to compete as in a woman's field, he's still, no matter how much testosterone he's changing or taking, his stroke is still is still gonna supersede a woman's.
Yeah, I agree. And honestly, it doesn't matter how much we train as women, we're not gonna be able to compete. Although we're like, we could do everything a man can do. I know that's, I'd be like, I can take you on. That's me talking hella shit. I know mentally I can't take you on, but I sure as hell will try. But realistically, there is no way. We're not built the same.
And I will try, but now if you look at it like this, let's just say your child is competing for a scholarship. And I just had this conversation with a friend at the 4th of July bash that we just had. Your child is competing for a scholarship for college, to be able to attend college, and now is going against a transgender to be able to go to college.
Yeah.
And now it's taken away from them. How do you feel as a parent? Like, okay, yes, you have to be open-minded. I'm totally open-minded, but I'm going to feel a certain type of way because now my child, who is a boy, just went against a girl, let's just say, and now she took it away from him because she identifies as this. I'm open to it, but now I do feel a certain type of way because I feel like they should not be in the same category. Even though, in order for them to be able to compete, there are requirements. There are requirements. You have to be taking a certain type of medication for a certain amount of time. You do have to be tested to have a certain amount of hormonal levels to be able to qualify. But still, you have, from birth, a certain gene in you that identifies you as a male or as a female.
So now, I believe it's the Netherlands. They're having their first transgender woman compete in the Olympics for weightlifting.
We have a viewer that says, when I was 15, I was 350 pounds. Imagine me playing football with a female, just saying. Now, what do you think if you were taking hormones for you, because you wanted to be a transgender person to play in a female, would that change your weight? I don't think so.
That, in regards to weight, I'm going to be honest, I'm not sure how that plays into it, like with the medications and stuff. But it, like I said, there are some advantages, like from when you're being born, it does make you physically different, even though, regardless of how many surgeries you have. Like, so in the Olympics, transgenders can now compete. They, I think, passed out like a few years ago. But like, if you're a male that went to a female and you want to compete in a women's team, they test your testosterone. So you have to be like at a certain level in order to compete for that female team.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have this issue right now where this lady, she's a natural born lady, but she has a genetic disorder where her testosterone is high. And they want her to take medication to like not control her testosterone levels. And she doesn't want to take any medication because she's like, this is how I'm born.
Right.
Now you also have other members from other teams that are saying, hey, that's why she always wins, because her testosterone is off the roof.
But it's not her trying to be a transgender.
No.
And identify as a male.
Yeah, but here's the issue. How do you regulate certain things? Like, in this case, she's was born this way. The transgender undergoes operations, medications, and stuff like that to choose that way. Do you think it's fair to apply the same rules to them, to someone that naturally has a disorder? It's not a choice they made. It's right. Not like you're seeking to compete in a male's team, because they were born as a female. It's just that she has a disorder. So how do you... my point is, you can't make the playing field level.
Right.
Unfortunately, you can't be like, all right, black is black, white is white, so it applies to everyone. Because it doesn't. Because now we have special rules for transgender, and unfortunately, we're trying to apply it to those that were born natural. But it's not fair to her, because it's just a genetic disorder. She didn't choose this. She was just born that way.
I mean, that is a good question. What do you guys think? Do you think because she was born that way, she's not trying to be a male competing in a male's category?
Correct.
She's female, born female. She just has a high level of testosterone because she was born that way. What do you guys think? Do you think she should take medication to bring that down to be on an equal playing field as other women?
Well, that's also like, I guess there's another transgender, if I'm correct, that was applying for the Olympics. And she qualified technically because like she met the signs, but all of a sudden the Olympics were saying, oh, she didn't qualify, but they're not giving the straight answer as to why. They're not saying like what made her disqualify.
Well, see, this is why I feel like right from the beginning, you have to set rules as to what you can do and what you can't. Because it's like when a female wants to play football, you can't because you're going against males. But then you have a women's league that you can now qualify for, or you should be able to play for.
And you know what's crazy? That testosterone testing, it's not like required for everyone. It's only when it's requested. So like if the coach from another team is like, I have questions, test her.
Mm-hmm.
That's how they do it.
Now see, that's not okay. I feel like if you want to test one, you have to test all.
It used to be that they tested everyone. But then, like I said, rules changed. We got more accepting. And now it's a request to test someone for testosterone. Like I think it's the medical chief, and I forget who else can make it this request to test someone for testosterone. Hence why you have that issue with the runner and her level's high, because another day competitor was like, oh my gosh, she's always winning, and she is African-American, I believe.
No, see, that's just hating status.
I agree. But on what point do you, like at the Olympics, are you like, oh, you're just being, you're jealous, you're racist, prejudiced? Why are you testing her and not no one else? Because she beat you a billion times?
Yeah.
So, but they tested her, hence why now she's, they're like, oh, well, she's not going to be able to compete if she doesn't take the medication. But then you have the other transgender, CC something, where they've not even given reason as to why she didn't qualify. But then you have a transgender from Netherlands that's competing for weightlifting so far. So I'm like, so where's all these rules? Like, how do you decide? How do you know, like, yes, no, that's an acceptance. And now how do we know that you're not discriminating or making crazy rules? Like, the swimming team for the Olympics, they said, you know, because African-Americans, like minorities have these special swim caps, they can't wear it for swimming. Because they said no one needs one that big. And how do we know that it doesn't give them advantages, X, Y?
Well, here's my thing. With the swimming and the swimming caps, if you are American and you want to wear that cap, you can. There ain't nobody telling you. And yes, I use the word ain't. It is what it is. There ain't nobody telling you you can't. You can wear the cap if you want. Unfortunately, you don't have the hair to fit it.
But you can't compete then. Because right now, we're competing in Tokyo, if I'm correct. So Tokyo is the one who gets to set the ground rules.
Oh, see, that's not okay. If you, I feel like you should have the rules in Tokyo, Australia, United States. It should all be equal.
No, I agree.
But I am not okay with a male, whether you identify as a female, competing in a female's.
Well, what about vice versa? As a female who's transitioning to a male, playing in a male?
No. Either or. If you're male, if you are born.
Something's on your mind.
If you are female, you should. If you are born female, you should be a. You should compete in a female category. If you are male, you should compete in a male category.
So you're saying
it's not what you identify with.
It should be what you're born with.
The same thing as restrooms. Mm-hmm. And I know I'm totally jumping off of that subject. But if you are born a male, use the male restroom. I do not care if you identify as a female and you're a male, then use the correct restroom. Because if I send my child who is 12, who cannot go to a female restroom, to a male's, I don't want you going into their bathroom. That's just my opinion.
I can see that. I honestly, I'm going to be honest, I just think people are creeps in general. So whether you're a guy who identifies as a female, whether you're a guy, whether you're a female who identifies as a male, or a female who identifies as a female, or as a computer or a toaster, I don't care. I just don't trust people in general, so I don't care what bathroom you choose. My kid's not going by himself, point blank.
Like, you have a daughter. I mean, I have sons. You have a daughter who is 14?
Which one are we talking about? The youngest? 13. Older, 16.
13. Or 16. Let's just say you wanted to let her go to the bathroom, and a male identifies as a female. Would you be okay with letting him go to the female bathroom?
I do this buddy system. I still do. It sounds horrible. She probably hates me for this. I know she's not a baby, but I don't give a shit. I don't trust people. That's my issue. I don't trust people, but I do with the buddy system. You guys going together.
Okay, but let's just didn't do the buddy system. Would you be okay with a male going, because he identifies as a female, going into the female restroom? I'm not okay with it.
I don't know. That's like a very iffy question, I'm going to be honest. And it's not like, oh, because I've met transgender people and I've never had, me personally, I haven't had an issue with them coming into the bathroom. It's just the person themselves.
So he's 28 and he identifies as a female going into
the bathroom. All right, is he attracted to females or attracted to males?
He's attracted to both.
Ah, hell no, someone's buying.
There you go. That's the point I'm trying to make. If he was attracted to males.
But then, plays devil advocate, what about pedophiles? They don't switch sexes. You never know. They look like everyone. You don't know when one's hopping into the bathroom when your kid's going in the bathroom.
Yeah. My 11-year-old comes into the girl's bathroom with me. Or he'll go into the bathroom with his brother. So, I mean, I'd be like, if you got a problem with it, my 12-year-old is coming in with me to the bathroom. So, unfortunately, your child
You can't protect them from everything in the world. Like, you just got to teach them basics. Like, hey, if something's like, yell.
Yeah.
I don't care how loud. If you got to break some shit, I don't do shit. Yeah. Break it. But, unfortunately, like, I try not, just because you're different or whatever, I'm not going to hold that prejudice against you. Because at the end of the day, we have people that look just like us that be doing some fucked up shit, too.
Yeah. Ding, 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 ding. I'm sorry. This topic is done. This topic is finished.
Oh, shit.
I'm sorry. If you have anything else that you want to send us it through inbox. You can write it here. Let us know how you feel. If you feel that we are incorrect, we're wrong, let us know.
Yeah, I'd love to listen to your opinions. I mean, I enjoy a healthy debate as long as the person debating can handle being like told. There's no right or wrong. It's like,
right.
A fight, a disagreement of opinions, better said. But at the end of the day, there's not like, all right, this is facts and I'm right.
Right. I mean, I'm not right. It's just my opinion. My opinion is right to me, but
I'm always right.
All right. So the next topic that we have is toxic traits. And this one, we did get a lot of people commenting on toxic traits. So a couple of responses that we got, and there was a lot of good ones that I wanted to comment. Toxic traits, reckless mouth, don't care whose feelings I hurt, it is what it is, quick to cut people off, I am too friendly. That's a good one.
Because I definitely have my share of that. Mm-hmm. We've spoken on that.
I get in my own head and tend to ruin things before others can ruin it. That's a good one and a bad one at the same time.
Because you're overthinking it.
You're overthinking it and you ruin it for yourself.
But it's not even because if you could overthink it in like good ways, where to the point that when you get yourself disappointed or overthink it as in like the what ifs, to the point that you don't even want to take that leap of faith no more because you already talked yourself out of it.
Right. Or what if you can ruin the best thing that can happen for you? Okay, and this next one is a toxic trait of myself, but somebody else commented it, so I don't feel bad. It's
she's like passive, a scared one.
Passive aggressive, throw shots like a motherfucker. And I am very, very, very passive aggressive. I tend to say things in a nice way, but very, very underneath, I'm very like, I can throw jabs. So a lot of you guys commented on that. So my toxic traits are, I'm needy, but with attention.
Okay.
And I had to ask somebody what my toxic traits was because I believe I'm perfect. So I asked somebody what my toxic traits were, because I didn't believe I had any.
We all got toxic traits.
No, I'm
and
perfect.
Anyone that says no is lying, and that's a red flag, and that's when you probably leave the relationship.
When they needs more ice. So
stop looking at my cup.
I was told
she's not even drinking hers.
I am. I flirt unintentionally, and I believe. Let me just say, I feel like I don't do that because I have RBF. I have resting bitch face where nobody wants to even speak to me because they feel like I am unapproachable.
So no, let's clarify. You do have resting bitch face, but I feel like it's more towards women. And I think it's because you hung out with guys so much growing up, you don't see it. You don't realize that you give resting bitch face to women, but to men, it's like a hit or miss.
Well, you know why? Because women were always so two-faced, where I knew guys always had my back.
Guys are two-faced too.
No, but let me explain. I always hung out with my brother and his friends, so I knew they always had my back. If anything, I always knew that I could call my brother and his friends, and they always had my back.
So they're the one who corrupted you.
I guess so.
So now I know we got beat up.
So I guess I was told that I flirt unintentionally, or I guess I'm too nice with men. I'm passive aggressive. I'm jealous. I am jealous. I am a very jealous person. What's mine is mine. I don't share. And I'm possessive.
So I'm going to be honest. I've only ever been jealous like once in my life, and I did not like it at all. Like, I was like, how do people live like this? Like, granted, clearly we're not together anymore, but I was just like, man, you know what I realized? It's because this fucker was just as friendly as I was. I should have known better.
But wait, you're friendly to a certain point. You're friendly, but respectful friendly.
I try to, but somehow people always misconstrue it as flirting. I swear to God, I'd like be at work, and I'd be like, what the fuck do y'all want? People like, damn, why are you so sassy? Can I play with your hair? I'm like, damn, fuck off! Like, but
a lot of people play with your hair.
They do. But I mean,
I don't find that to be toxic.
No, but I do know I'm like friendly, and I over the years I've definitely had to monitor it because I'm like, they're like, oh, I swear. So I have, you know, Patrick, we are really close friends. We went out one time and he was like, oh, I thought you were hooking up with this other friend. I was like, why? He's like, y'all just looked like y'all had something. I'm like, we're just friends. And he's like, you guys were way too friendly though. So, me being friendly and them being friendly and us together being friendly does not look good when you're in a relationship. But I know I am too friendly to the point, like I told you, I've had friends that are like, oh, I don't want you to meet my significant other because they feel some type of way because I'm just way too friendly. Okay. Granted, I've had experience where it turns out their crushes had ended up having a crush on me just because, I don't know, I'm just oblivious to it. I'm just a laid back.
Okay. Now let's talk about toxic traits where are harmful to you, where you find yourself staying in certain situations where it's bad and you need to get out of it, but because you're so comfortable in it,
complacency,
yes, that you can't get out.
Meaning that they trust too fast, not friendly as flirting. Okay. Oh, that's a really good one too. And I feel like that's not a bad thing. It's only bad when you get hurt, because there's not enough trust in this world. So it's like an almost like this little ball of hope.
Here's my thing. I feel like you can trust people, and it's not a bad thing until they show you that you can't trust them.
Exactly.
Because, or let's just say with people that you're dating, you have to trust them. It's for some reason you have liked them, you fell in love with them, whatever the case may be. But the minute they show you that you can't trust them anymore, you have to let that go. Because they showed you their true colors from the beginning. There ain't no, and I said the word again, there isn't any changing. If they showed you what they are, they're not going to change. No matter how much you wish they are, they're not going to change nothing.
I feel like that's more of a female trait, where we see the potential and we hold on because we try to mold and change them to meet that potential.
Men also, though, because women, let me just explain. Women will show you a side of them that is there. Oh, you're getting more ice?
Yeah, more ice.
Women will show you what is there. And you're hoping that they can change as well. For instance, mm-hmm. Jealousy.
Yeah.
Possessiveness. Bad attitudes. If they show you what is there, take it for what it is. If she's jealous, she's not letting you go out. You can't hang with your friends. If it's always a problem. And you're hoping she's going to change. She's not. That is her. That is her character. Take it for what it is.
But unfortunately, there are a handful of people that do change.
There are. There's a handful.
So, I guess it's just about the time you invest. Like, if after a while you notice, like, hey, this isn't changing, it's still the same thing, she's not working on it, you gotta cut your losses. Like, you hear constantly about red flags and how we stick around because we want to turn a blind eye to it in hopes that well, they'll overcome it, but those red flags are there for a reason. Like, if it's something that's telling you, like, hey, this is something you should be keeping an eye out on, keep an eye out on it. Like, you can't just be like, oh, that guy, he's just friendly. He's not a flirt. He's not going to cheat on me. If he cheated on you with so-and-so and so, it's not going to change. Because you hear that all the time. Well, I know he cheated on me with so-and-so, but he's not going to do it to me because he loves me. I'm not doing it, but I'm just saying. These women groups are very fun to read.
Right. I took a long time to stop doing that. And sometimes, unfortunately, you have to learn to hit rock bottom. And people can tell you, oh, don't do that.
Yeah, that's true.
Don't do that. But sometimes you have to learn by falling and doing that in order for you to stop doing that. As bad as it sounds, my dad used to tell me all the time, why can't you learn from advice? Because I'm the type of person that has to learn from hitting rock bottom to learn to not do that.
So in regards to learning from advice, you have to keep in mind, though, everyone's experience is different. So I can sit here and be like, oh, but you know, I've gone through this and this is what I did, X, Y, and Z. You and I are not the same.
No.
So how I felt in this situation does not pertain to exactly how you feel.
Right.
So you're going to view it and be like, all right, well, that's you, and I'm not you.
I can change that person. Hell no, I can't change that person.
Don't come to me, I can't change nobody. I'm going to just tell you that right now. If you effed up, you're going to stay effed up.
Yeah. But then sometimes you can change a person.
Do I want to, though? Like, all right, here's the concept. I met you the way you are.
Yeah.
You have potential, that's awesome. but I met you this way. I should not be expecting you to change.
Right.
But I see this potential and I'm like, oh my God, you could be so much more. At some point, I can try to nudge you and push you and help you and guide you and all this other bullshit to get you to be this potential that I see in you, this greatness or whatever the fuck you want to call it. But at some point, I gotta be like, all right, I pushed and guided and assisted and helped and dropped so much, I'm done.
Right.
So then you cut your losses.
Right.
But at some point, you're gonna be like, that's not my job. I should be focusing on myself and making myself reach this potential. And whoever I am with will hopefully want to reach their potential because I motivate them, not because I'm pushing for them to reach it.
Is there a toxic trait that you've noticed in yourself that you've corrected? There's a topic. Okay. So, there is one. I was very, a toxic trait. I was not unloving. There was a toxic, yeah. I was very unloving. I did not show emotion.
Okay.
In the past. And I corrected it. And now, it's like I'm now over-possessive and I show it too much and I'm jealous. Oh. About it, and I was told about that, so now I pull back from that a lot, because before I used to be like, what do you want me to do, sit on top of you and hump you? Like, Jesus, I just told you that I love you, it is what it is. And now I'm like over possessive with you. So is there a toxic trait that you realize was bad and now you've corrected it, but now you have another toxic trait that you have to work on?
That's a very good one.
I stopped when I realized it. That's good.
And that's the thing, because you can notice your own toxic trait, but it's always a constant thing. Like, you always have to be mindful of it, because these are old habits. You fall right back if you're not constantly being conscious of it. Because I know there's no, I'm like, I'm going to try to stop that. I'm going to try to stop that. Because I had an issue where not everyone wants to hear the truth, and you need to accept that. So as much as they're like, I want better, I want to improve, so you telling them the truth, like, oh, well, if you do this, or if you do this, or have you looked into this, it's just them. Like, they're their own worst enemies sometimes, and you can't push that. And I realize that some people don't take that well, because they just want to be able to say they want to, but they don't have any intentions of going through with it. So by you trying to push and guide them, you're kind of taking that whole illusion away from them. Like, you're not letting them live in their own little freaking bubble anymore.
Yeah.
So I definitely had to be mindful of being like, all right, depending on who I'm talking to, like, all right, I can say little things here, but I can't constantly, like, push you, because not everyone deals with that well.
And you had your uncle to help you in your mistakes. Future topic. I did. So I do have family that is watching and commenting. So, and a lot of the mistakes and toxic traits that I had, I did have family that helped me, that saw when I was going down a bad path or self-destructing, or helped pull me back and make sure I realized what I was doing.
Oh,
I mean, I was already hitting the brick building, but they were there to help support.
Yeah.
So, I mean, when you have somebody, even though you have to realize it on your own, when you do have family, friends, a significant other telling you, hey, this is bad, maybe you want to change it, sometimes it's got to click and you maybe want to open up a little bit to accepting advice that people are giving you to change these traits and take you out of what, you know, is harming you, either mentally, physically, or anything like that.
And let's talk about, I know our subject is toxic traits, but how about toxic masculinity? I feel like that's very prominent in the Hispanic culture.
Explain more.
All right.
Let's go into more detail. We have a couple more minutes.
So you know how, especially like in older times, like the man ran the house. Like, hey, you know, I'm trying to think of one that my grandma used to say. I'm blanking out right now. But it's kind of like, hey, you know, you want to be a good wife to him. You want to cater to him. You want to do this for him. Cook for him. Like that. And then they grow up thinking like they're entitled. Like, my woman should do this. My woman should do that.
Yeah,
like,
that's a toxic trait men have. Spanish men.
That's what I'm saying. That toxic masculinity that we develop in the Hispanic culture.
Yes.
Like, I feel like we enable that. Because I can tell you growing up, me and my sister and stuff had to clean everything, but my brother saw your eyes.
Oh, me. My eyes almost fell out. I rolled them so bad. I do. I'm going to have to drink to this one because...
No. But like I was saying, growing up, my mom would... My brother didn't have to do chores because he was a male. He was a guy. Why does he need to? Because he'll have a wife to do that for him. Meanwhile, my sister and I had to learn how to cook and clean and do dishes and wash the laundry and everything. Like, those were our responsibility. Why do we... Granted, times are changing, so not all of us are teaching our sons to be like that.
No.
But back then, that was something normal, like toxic masculinity. Like I said, I feel like that's very prominent in this Hispanic culture. Like, we raise our sons to expect to be waited on.
I feel like a lot of women, the older generation women, gave the men that toxic trait to feel entitled to that.
Yeah.
As we go, our generation goes progressing, we're taking that toxic trait away from the men. Mind you, there are still some women that are giving them that.
sorry, that comment.
But you have to train them from the beginning, meaning it's a partnership. Yes, it is a partnership. And a lot of the current generations are training the men that now is how you do it. But hey, I tried to cook for my family, but no one wanted Chef Boyardee. But yes, like growing up, my mother used to give my dad that.
Yeah.
That entitlement.
That servitude.
I don't. That doesn't fly.
Nope.
In our household. I'm sorry. If you feel that you're entitled to that, you better get your own house that you live in by yourself.
Well, that's almost kind of like, you know how you get catcalled when you're a younger girl, and you hear some families are like, oh, take that as a compliment. They think you're pretty or whatever. And be like, now when you're older, you're like, ew. But like at the kid, you were like, all right, my mom, my so-and-so said it's fine. Like, it's just a compliment. That's why they're catcalling me. Like, you didn't know what, like, harassment was and stuff like that.
You know what? I used to think that was so cute. Like, ooh, they got Kelly me. Like,
I hated it. I hated it. I would not give nobody the time of day. Like, my whole thought process was, I guess I was stubborn to begin with. I'd be like, ew, I don't think it's fun that you're driving by and whistling at me. And then they'd be like, you, bitch. I'd rather be the bitch.
No, I used to walk by and be like, oh, I'm cute.
Not me. I'm meanwhile, cute. I'm just like, leave the fuck alone.
No.
I'm always hating people.
A lot of Spanish men do think that, you know, the women have to do the cooking. They can just sit down and relax. But unfortunately,
that we're here to pop out babies for them.
It's or that, you know, we have to do most of the chores. But let me tell you what. This is what I say. If I have to cook, clean, and work, I mean... Let me explain that. If I have to cook, clean, do laundry, take care of the children, then he should be able to afford all the bills by himself, make sure that my nails are done, my hair is done, my clothes is up to date. Mm-hmm. If he can't handle that by himself, then guess what? We have to share all of the other bills all of the other chores so that I can work, so that we both can maintain everything that we have to. So if that's a toxic trait that he has, he's got to correct that, because if not, he's going to be by himself in his own house by himself.
You know, and it's, you know who I've noticed that has that a lot? I mean, we say Hispanic, but Mexicans. So I know this Mexican family, like it's like a multiple family that lives in a household. And I will never forget the one time all the men are literally sitting on the porch. The women came out, served them their foods. They're eating. The women go and they're taking out the trash. And I mean, these bags are heavy. Like, you can tell because they're struggling. They're carrying it out. The men are not even just, like, helping. They're literally just eating and watching them bring out these trash cans. And then the baby starts crying. And all you hear is like, hey, take it on the baby. And he's like, all right. She throws it out to the corner. She's running back in to get the baby. And she's holding the baby and grabbing another bag. And I'm like, what the fuck? I was like, it could have been me because I might have set the house on fire. But
she said, cook, clean, and fuck them good. Yeah, that's what men expect.
And what do I get? I mean, they make toys. I can please myself.
Hey, hey, don't mess with your man. Just let the man cook. Some here. But yeah, I mean, I'm sorry. It's 50-50.
Time's changing.
It is changing. And if not, you better get yourself an old woman that still thinks like that.
Well, I think it was also, too, because back then, men made the money. Like, you know how you always hear, like, for every dollar a man makes, a woman makes, like, 80 cents and stuff. Well, times are changing.
Not no more.
Exactly. Yeah, we about to make the same or more than you, honestly. So,
yeah.
You can't say, I make the money, I'm bringing home the bacon, so cook the bacon.
Yeah. I mean,
that's probably why I'm never gonna get married. I'm like, this bitch is too difficult.
Maybe that's why my husband don't leave me.
Because you're too difficult, or maybe he's afraid he's gonna die.
Let me stop. All right, we have 1 minute left. 1 minute left on this topic. Does anybody else have anything else to say?
I have a question. Are you guys even drinking? Are y'all, like, watching us sober? Like, I can't imagine that's entertaining, to be honest.
Yeah. No, I'm drinking.
We are, but we don't have to watch each other. Like, we're drinking and doing this, but for them that are watching us, I hope they're drinking. Well, alcohol makes everything better.
Since we have a minute, I'm going to say, if you have a toxic trait that is bad, try and break free from it. If it's keeping you in a situation that you don't want to be in, remove yourself from it. Find the willpower inside of you to remove yourself from it. If it's a toxic trait that you are okay with and others aren't, so be it. If you're okay with it, it's not hurting anybody, you're fine with it, embrace it. If they don't like it, oh well. You know the saying, what you don't like, don't eat. So just tell them, don't eat it.
Well, keep in mind too, sometimes we all need that help or that push to get over a toxic trait. So if you need to seek help, it's okay. Like, we have such a stigma against, like, counselors and psychologists and psychiatrists. Like, it's okay to have that outside help, because you need to accept, like, our brain works in what ways that we will never fully comprehend. If we need that assistance to guide us and help us, your support groups and internet and everything, there's just ways to go about it.
You ladies are great.
Yes, yeah, thank you.
We are great. We're going to tell you how it is.
Exactly. That's one of the things that's constantly... I used to say that a lot. Well, if you don't like it, you can leave. That's just how I am. And I've been working on that, though.
And remember, everybody has toxic traits. Nobody's perfect. It is what it is. So, we have our last topic, which is education. This one's big on me, which... it's charter school. My children are in a charter school. They did not start in a charter school. They started in a public school. And I ripped them out of the public school. And I have friends that are still... I mean, I have a friend that... She goes to bat for public school and funding for public school. I go to bat for charter school and funding for charter schools. And I'll tell you why. Whatchamacallit? Number one, if you don't know, even though your child is in a charter school, your child, if they pertain to a public school, that public school still gets funding for your child, even though they're not in the public school, they're in a charter school. They still get a percentage of it. I will go to bat and I still protest for it. If my child is not in the public school, I feel like the public school should not get any funding for my child. They still get, I think it's like 26 or 24%.
Yeah, something like that. Like, it's almost upward of 30%, while the charter school gets 70%, something like that.
Yeah. And I have a friend, and we debate about it. We go against each other when we're at Harrisburg. We'll see each other, and we'll, like, say hi. But then when we're debating, we're debating.
Yeah.
Because I feel like public school does such a disadvantage for children. It's not funny.
So in regards to public school, I agree to you with you on up to a certain extent, because it depends on the public school. Because now if you go to like Parkland, like their funding's a whole lot more. So it definitely depends on the district itself. You can't be like all public school, because if you're in a Parkland school district, you're getting an amazing education because your funding's ridiculous.
I agree. So let me... My child pertains to Allentown School District. Yeah. Allentown. School district sucks balls. That's where my kids pertain to. And they were there. And Kazen, he got horrible schooling. When Caleb started there, he got horrible schooling. So that's when I decided to pull them from there, and they go now to a charter school. And the charter school that they go to, which is Lincoln Leadership Academy, it's amazing. And I feel like for Allentown to still get funding and take away from Lincoln is such a disadvantage. And Lincoln is still trying and still doing an amazing job.
With the limited funding.
With the limited funding. And now Allentown wants to take more from Lincoln. I think it's total bullshit.
I definitely agree. I understand, like, Allentown School District, because they have so many students, because it's such a populated city, that their funding doesn't cover all of them. But to take away from another school because their kid goes to a charter school, I think it's wrong. Now, I do think that maybe the state needs to reevaluate its funding and give Allentown a bigger funding, as opposed from having them try to fight the charter school to take it. Now, this funding is usually based off of testing. And now you have that, like, well, where's the money going? Because the education is not the greatest, the school is not the greatest, the textbook's outdated.
Before you continue, this doesn't mean that we're attacking teachers, we're not attacking the school, we're not attacking... If you're a teacher and you participate in Allentown School District, by all means, we're not attacking you, we're not attacking the district, we're not attacking anything. We're just talking about funding and if you pertain to the school or not. Just putting it out there. I have friends that are teachers. It is what it is. If you take it that way, it is what it is.
So, my kids started out in public school, and I loved their elementary school. But as soon as my oldest was getting ready to transition to middle school, luckily we lucked out, she was able to enroll at Lincoln before she went to public middle school. Now, she would have been going to Trexler, and maybe right around that time, that was a year, like, Trexler, I don't know what the hell happened, but for a while there, like, their students were sitting in the auditorium for like a month with no teacher because they didn't have no coverage. They weren't learning anything, like, no, nothing. And the parents didn't find out till like weeks later. And that's an issue I have.
Listen to this. Allentown made me quit the day of with no regards to my special ed students. And they owe me money during a pandemic. I finished the week with no pay just for the students.
Damn. I respect that you have that much dedication to the students, but Allentown School District is fucked up in that aspect.
I think the majority of it has to do with, okay, so Allentown School District, the teachers, they give you a contract for 4 years, whether you're a good teacher or not. With the charter schools, you have a contract of 1 year.
Yeah.
Whether you're a good teacher or not, if they choose to revoke your contract, you're done. If you're an amazing teacher, you'll continue. If you're not, you're done.
Yeah. And I love, like, a lot of the teachers that come back are students.
Yeah.
Like, yes. They come back to work at the school they graduated from. If that doesn't say something, I don't know what does. But, like, and like I said, I'm not going to knock all of the public schools because I loved the elementary school they were. The teachers were overworked.
Wendy needs ice.
Stop looking at my goddamn cup. Like, the teachers the teachers were overworked, but they were amazing. Like, honestly, so they went to Ramos Elementary School. A lot of the teachers stayed after school, and they weren't getting paid for it. Like, they were volunteering their time at this point. Like, whether it be Girls on the Run, Boy Scouts, like, they were in there, and they, you see them interacting with the students. Like, I can't say anything bad about Ramos because my kids had an amazing experience with the teachers there. I met the teachers. I interacted with them. They were beyond helpful, like, amazing. Now I have a friend whose kid is in Allen, and the parent has been trying to get a hold of the school right now because it's summer school. Like, the school started like that Monday. He tried like for 2-3 days to get a hold of someone. They'd be like, I called you back. They haven't called them back. Like, the communication, like, from Trexler to Allen has sucked balls, because I've been with her trying to make the calls, trying to get through to someone. And we've just been watching them not communicating back. But meanwhile, right now my kids are at Lincoln. I send an email. They answer right back, whether it be that same day or the next day. They'll freaking, I'm like, yo, here's my number. They'll call me. They'll text, like, anything. They're like, oh, hey, I noticed something's not right. Like, changing attitude. Like, is everything okay at home? They know to contact me. Granted, I do make myself available. And that's another issue I noticed with downtown school district, the parents expect the teacher to be involved, but you need to be involved as a parent as well. And unfortunately, you have some parents that feel like it's a teacher responsibility to teach, and they don't have to do it.
Right. Now, the one thing that I do love, since we're talking about it, Central. My child didn't get to go to Ramos. My child went to Central. And my youngest, he has, those that know him, he may look like his dad, but he acts like me. He's a little bit difficult, but it's because he may act like me, but he has a couple of other things that's going on. So when he was in elementary school, he was going through testing to figure out, you know, he had a couple of disabilities. Number one, he has Asperger's, ADHD, anxiety disorder, and XYY syndrome. So he was going through testing to try to figure out what he had. I went to Central. I said, he's going through testing to try to figure out what he had. Can you be patient with him? There was a teacher there who was like, well, you know, she didn't want to be flexible to try and figure out. She's like, I have all these other students. I don't give a shit about all the other students. I'm trying to talk to you about my child.
Yeah.
Well, needless to say, she grabbed him by his jacket and kind of lifted him. So I grabbed her hand and I twisted it.
Why is she even touching her kid?
Exactly. So she told me, you can't do that to me. I said, you can't do that to him. That was the last draw that I had at Central. So the principal was calling me, the superintendent was calling me, and I was like, you know, I'm pulling him. I said, I have notes trying to figure out what's going on with my kid. I moved him to Lincoln. Lincoln, he got accepted into Lincoln. The teachers there and the CEO there was so understanding with him. They figured out ways to work with him, and it was just amazing. It was different because even though their funding is different than the funding for Allentown School District, and it's less, they actually worked with him.
Yeah.
She figured out ways. So because of his ADHD, she actually, this is just an example, she actually got a big rubber band to put on his chair. So when he was feeling anxious, he would like jump on it. And it would actually take away from what he was feeling and experiencing in his mind and body so that he could focus. It was simple things. She had just as many students as the teacher in Central. She just went the extra mile to figure out what was working for him. And to me, it's just kind of like, it's, do you have what it takes to want to teach? When you have teachers that have a contract already, it's like, what can you do? You can't kick me out until the 4 years are up.
That's true. But you also have to keep in mind, you have the overworked teacher, the not enough support teachers. Because, like, you see all that stuff in their classroom?
Yeah.
That is out of the teacher's pocket. The school, they do not get reimbursed.
Right.
And the school does not pay for it. Like, so all that extra stuff, that teacher is going to go get it. So you might see them doing, like, GoFundMes or, like, those little funding projects to pay for stuff, because that is literally out their pocket.
And not only that, but I'm sorry to interrupt. I didn't mean to interrupt you. But Lincoln requires parents to participate.
Yes.
Is it, like, 82 or 84% of what's going on? If you were part of a school district, you require the parents to be active. If not, your child is out. But Allentown School District, you can't do that.
They can't do that because by the state, no child left behind. They have, like, just same thing with the cell phones. They can't take the cell phones away from the students. But Lincoln has that whole policy where they collect that at the beginning and returns it at the end.
Yes.
So they're not getting distracted during class. And I love that.
It says, Central has such bad memories with my kids. Nope, Central is the worst. I started there. That is awesome. Let's not even talk about tenure. If they get tenured, it's over.
That's true. Yeah. So, like I said, and for all the faults the Allentown School District has, and I do believe they have many, but it's also just, like, how many times do they have the Allentown School Board meetings? How many parents show up to that?
None.
I have a friend, and he doesn't even have kids, and he's in that meeting all the time. And I'd be like,
let me explain. So, Kazen was at Harrison Morton. And he wasn't doing good. And mind you, he has an IEP. So during his math teacher, he was there in the sixth grade. I said, okay, I will buy Kazen a notebook. I want you to just write on there. Kazen will write what he has. So if you can sign it, and if there's no homework, just sign on there. She took, you know what his math teacher, which I wanted to take the notebook and smack her in the freaking face with it. And everybody knows I would do it. She said, do you know how many, students I have in the class? I don't have time for that. So when you say there's no parent participation, if I'm telling you, I'm trying to make sure my child passes, I'm trying to work with you, and you tell me you don't have time for it, now what do you expect?
See, and that's what I mean, like, when you have that overworked teacher, that teacher that just doesn't care, or, like, so my youngest brother graduated from Allen. Do you know him and a group of his friends went to the principal to report that there was a teacher that they felt that was not doing his job? He's a high schooler. You know how many students would have just ran with that and just gotten that easy A? He's like, we're not learning anything. And yeah. The school was just like, oh, we'll look into that. That dude was still working there. Nothing changed. My brother left very upset. Like, I'm supposed to be learning stuff. Like, I like want to learn about this subject, and we're not learning shit because he's not teaching shit.
Oh, man, we have 1 minute, guys. 1 minute. Let us know.
Oh, my God. And it's not to say that Lincoln's perfect, because I have some issues with them as right. well. Like, not in regards to teaching, but more, like, in regards to, like, after-school activities. The communication's on par.
PTA meetings.
Like, I can't complain about communication. They are spectacular.
And no school is perfect.
Yeah, exactly. But when it comes to education, when you have a kid in a school, it's not all on the teacher's responsibility. It requires parents' requirement, like, participation as well. Because I've heard stories from teachers. So put one out there. Third grade classroom. This boy is commenting on a student's girl's ass, making her feel uncomfortable. The teacher calls the parents in. Hey, your son's commenting on her ass. You know, it's not appropriate. X, Y, and Z. The parent was like, oh, well, he's a guy. At least we know he's not gay. It's fine.
Oh, no.
Like, instead of being like, yo, dude, you're here to learn. Like, what the hell?
Yeah.
Just let it go. So this teacher had to kind of be like, oh, they're not allowed to be together. That's their resolution.
Oh, we're done.
We are.
Oh, man, guys. Thank you so much for participating today. We appreciate it. Remember to send us your topics.
Yes. We're available anytime. You can DM us, comment, whatever, if there's a certain topic. Or if you, even if it's not for us to broadcast and you just want to talk about it on social media, we definitely could post it and just have, like, a nice little conversation or debate or whatever else you want to call it. You know, why are they so worried about ICE?
Their basketball program, yes.
Whose basketball program?
Lincoln's.
Anyways. No, I don't have an issue with the basketball program. My oldest is in their basketball program. And the coach has been nothing but amazing, like, texting, checking up. It's their other sports, like, for middle school and stuff. It's yeah. non-existent.
Yes. Volleyball. There's so much more we can talk about. Yes. And like we said, there's so much more that you can work with.
Why do I feel like I'm writing something that much?
Bye, guys.